Because it's a long time since I last spoke English in public. My talk, I titled it Reduced Listening and Ethnography. In fact, I'm not going to talk about reduced listening, and I'm not going to talk about ethnography. But I'm going to approach ethnography through reduced listening. My colleague Rodolphe Kaeser said today, no, yesterday, that he didn't wish to talk about the sonic object or the sound object or reduced listening because he didn't want to fall into this dichotomy subject-object. But he said, he added, that he doesn't think this has to do with reduced listening. Rodolphe said that he understands reduced listening as a poetics. And that's the way I understand it. So what I'm going to do, let me open here a short plan of my talk. I'm going to speak about a piece of music, which is called Na Faixa de Gaza é Assim, that can be translated as In the Gaza Strip, It's This Way. This Gaza Strip has nothing to do with the Israeli conflict. That's a street in Rio de Janeiro, a street which crosses the Manguinhos complex of favelas and leads into Complexo do Alemão, which used to be a very tense area because there were communities, favelas, linked to different factions. So this was originally known, it was known as Faixa de Gaza. I used this expression, cartography of listening. I don't think it's very correct. The term cartography of listening sounds nice and trendy, but it's not exactly what I propose to do. I'm going to try and to rescue my path of listening to this song. This is obviously a fiction because I cannot here recreate this song as I listen to it. So it's somehow a little piece of fiction which seeks to portray how I got engaged with this piece of music. The year was 2011. The song, at the time I didn't know it, the song dates from 2009. It was created in March 2009. And it projected a then unknown MC into national stardom. MC Orelha, which is the name of the author, composer, singer, and producer, became one of the best known MCs of the Proibidão subgenre of funk carioca. Proibidão is a subgenre, as I understand it, a subgenre that deals with so-called life in crime. So let's start with the music, or at least the a cappella.
Na faixa de Gaza, some bomba, na guerra é tudo ou nada. Várias titânio no pente, colete à prova de bala. Nós desce pra pista pra fazer o assalto, mas tá fechadão no 12. Se eu tô de rolé, 600 bolado, perfume importado, pistola no couro. Mulher, ouro e poder, lutando que se conquista. Nós não precisa de crédito, nós paga tudo à vista. É Eco, Lacoste, é peça da Oakley, várias camisa de time. Quem tá de fora até pensa que é mole viver do crime. Nós planta humildade pra colher poder, a recompensa vem logo após. Não somos fora da lei, porque a lei quem faz é nós. Nós é o certo pelo certo, não aceita a covardia. Não é qualquer um que chega e ganha moral de cria. Consideração se tem pra quem age na pureza, pra quem tá mandado o papo é reto. Bota as peças na mesa. Quantos amigos eu vi e morar com Deus no céu, sem tempo de se despedir, mas fazendo o seu papel. Por isso eu vou mandar, por isso eu vou mandar sim. Comando vermelho, RL até o fim. É vermelhão desde pequenininho. Só menor bolado nas favelas do baixinho. Não dá, não dá, não dá, não. Por isso eu mando assim. Comando vermelho, RL.
Well, I was, as I listened to it, I was very impressed by the power of his elocution. And I started trying to explain why it had such expressive power. And I trying to verbalize it, what occurred to me it is that it was very imperious. The way he speaks, he sings, and at the same time, there's nothing mechanical about the way he speaks. So, the first thing that I did was to produce an acousmography of this track. You say, well, you speak about reduced listening, and you get a graphic representation. Yes, I do it, and I don't think there is any contradiction between one thing and the other. Second thing, you speak about reduced listening, and you are trying to find out how the track was produced. So you're introducing causality into reduced listening. And I will say, yes, I'm doing that. And I don't think there's anything wrong with it, because this definition of reduced listening, which states that reduced listening is listening to a sound without any reference to its sound-producing event or to its meaning. It may be correct, but it's not true. That's what I think. So the first thing I did was one thing I noticed. That was perhaps the start, that his intakes of breathing are very strongly marked. So I marked his intakes of breathing with white circles. Let's see what it looks like. That's a spectrogram, and above the spectrogram, you have a representation of signal. And inside this representation of signal, I inserted the lyrics.
Na faixa de Gaza, some bomba, na guerra é tudo ou nada. Várias titânio no pente, colete à prova de bala. Nós desce pra pista pra fazer o assalto, mas tá fechadão no 12. Se eu tô de rolé, 600 bolado, perfume importado, pistola no couro. Mulher, ouro e poder, lutando que se conquista. Nós não precisa de crédito, nós paga tudo à vista. É Eco, Lacoste, é peça da Oakley, várias camisa de time. Quem tá de fora até pensa que é mole viver do crime. Nós planta humildade pra colher poder, a recompensa vem logo após. Não somos fora da lei, porque a lei quem faz é nós. Nós é o certo pelo certo, não aceita a covardia. Não é qualquer um que chega e ganha moral de cria. Consideração se tem pra quem age na pureza, pra quem tá mandado o papo é reto. Bota as peças na mesa. Quantos amigos eu vi e morar com Deus no céu, sem tempo de se despedir, mas fazendo o seu papel. Por isso eu vou vou mandar, por isso eu vou mandar sim. Comando vermelho, RL até o fim. É vermelhão desde pequenininho. Só menor bolado nas favelas do baixinho. Não dá, não dá, não dá, não.
So, one of my questions was it recorded live? Because it sounds as if it had been recorded live. There is an old style Proibidão musical production, which is characterized by the following format. The MC sings the verse, reaches the chorus, and when he reaches the chorus, he asks the DJ to release the breakbeat, and he repeats da capo ao fine. It's exactly what he does here. But having produced this acousmography, I was able to realize that he doesn't sing it twice. It's only one take, which has been selected, copy, and pasted side by side. So there is no repetition, and it has not been recorded live. When I found this out, I think a good part of the enigma of the power of his delivery was sorted out. What happens? I call this a retroduction with reference to Peirce terminology, which is an intuitive inference from the judgment of perception of an hypothesis subject to verification. What's my retroduction? I assumed that he recorded this track while listening to the breakbeat. And the breakbeat is this one. It's a particular breakbeat in the period of transition between tamborzão and beatbox. If you are familiar with the samba drumming, it has characteristically an accent on the second beat. So I imagine he was listening to this beat over headphones while recording. His intakes of breathing were noise because his ears were locked. The breakbeat masked his breathing. And he had two points of reference for rhythm. First beat, second beat, and in between one and the other, his divisions, rhythmic divisions, were more or less flexible. So that was my reduced listening. Ethnography came later on in the guise of an interview with him, and he confirmed my hypothesis. He recorded this track in his bedroom. It should have been a pre-production. It was the beginning of his career, or the beginning of the successful part of his career. The pre-production was so successful that his DJ did not have the time to make a real production. So in this case, ethnography confirmed my hypothesis. I'm the second part of my talk, I'll speak of another hypothesis which I reject, but which was probably right. The second thing that marked me was the fact that when one analyzes the spectrogram, there are two very salient segments to my mind. Let the figure open this one. Why is this segment somewhat out of the ordinary? Because there are more oscillations in pitch than anywhere else in the song. While he says, echo, Lacoste, peça da Oakley, and the acousmograph allows you to change velocity. So if you hear it in other velocities.
Teco Lacoste, é peça da Oakley.
Teco Lacoste, é peça da Oakley.
Teco Lacoste, é peça da Oakley.
I was intrigued by this figure, which I called figure of life, because a lot of things happened here, and because he was speaking about the opulence of life in crime. That was 2011, and a dear colleague, who was Elizabeth Travassos, invited me to talk about Proibidão in one of his classes. And I showed this and I said, I cannot understand what all these waves mean. And someone, one of her students, immediately said, that's a peddler's cry, um grito de camelô. I said, it can't be. That makes no sense. What sense does it make a camelot to use the voice of a camelot to speak about the opulence of life in crime? That does not make any sense. Well, the following year, when I interviewed MC Aurelia, and that's, I have to talk about his life, was a great, I won't say it was a great interview, I think it was a great interview, but it was great interviewing him because I made him some very difficult questions. He received me quite friendly and with complete trust. So he answered my questions, even though they were not, some of them were somewhat problematic. So he told me that he was born in a favela in Niterói, Capim Melado, that he went to school there, that at some point he went to a school in an upper class neighborhood, a state school in Santa Rosa, now it's Icaraí, which is an upper class part of Niterói. And it was contrary to expectations, it was in this upper class neighborhood that he became acquainted with life in crime, that he started seeing people smoking pot, people being killed by guns, and this kind of things. And he became himself, now I miss the English word for menor infrator. What is it? No, delinquent is somewhat charged, somehow charged. a young person, in politically correct language, not delinquent, but an underage in state of conflict with the law. And he immediately told me, I didn't do anything in drug dealing, but I, how do I say sequestrar in English? I kidnapped, and he was sent to the place where these people are sent. What is it called in English, please? No, it's not a prison. Juvenile Detention Center. Thank you. He was shocked by what he saw there. He escaped. He went back to school. He started living with someone. He started to cap his singing career, and he worked as a peddler. So, in fact, this must be the shout of a peddler. And then what happened? I said, well, before I explain the place of this verse in the whole song, I want to mention the second moment which called my attention, which is a kind of antithetical moment, which I called figure of mourning. View, enter full screen. Here, when he says, sem tempo de se despedir, mas fazendo, nothing happens here. You can see there's no change, noticeable change of pitch, no noticeable change of envelope shape. And even you can, if you wish to go into representation analysis, you can see that it's almost symmetrical, left and right. And there are some relationships which you can establish sound-wise as well. So my listening was guided by these two antithetic figures, which I called the figure of life and the figure of death, of mourning rather than death. Yes, I know I've already gone 2 minutes too far, but I'll stop shortly. So what occurred to me was, if these moments are so striking to me, perhaps they have a kind of structural importance in the song. And I was surprised to see that, yes, they did. Because this figure, which I call figure of life, the peddler call, it appears exactly in the middle of the verse. That's to say, it's from the biographical point of view, the peddler divides his life into the delinquent, as my colleague Suzel says, and the successful MC. So it's a kind of divisor de águas. Divider. It's a divider. And the figure, what I call the figure of mourning, it precedes the chorus, in which he expresses his adhesion to a criminal faction, Comando Vermelho. So I told you this story as an illustration of the way in which reduced listening, as I understand it, and ethnography, meaning here an interview, may bear some kind of fruit. That's it. Thank you for your attention. pode tirar o som, acho que isso. Pode, claro. Você me ajuda a tirar.
É assim?
Não.
Uma tiara.
Eu não sei por onde isso vai.
Por baixo. Ai, ai. Oh. Ah, tá. Pronto. Não, não vale gravar. Okay. Well, good afternoon. Thank you, Lilian, Fernando, Rui. For the invitation. Sorry for my English too. I will read because of this, because I thought it, I had 30 minutes and it's 20, and I think it's better to follow the script. Well, this paper explores translocal musicking and the transformative potential it has on audiences, places, and performers. Musicking produces both localities and identities. And what we want to discuss here is what kinds of localities and identities are being produced and negotiated by this new kind of African migration that arrives recently in São Paulo and the music that comes with it. How does Brazilian music scene incorporate these new bodies, and how does it deal with their ideas and representations of contemporary reality? This work is part of an ongoing research project that's called Being Becoming African in Brazil, Migrating Musics and Heritage. It's a project that I'm developing with Jasper Shawcraft, that's a researcher from University of Sussex in the UK. And it's part of a larger framework project called Local Musicking, New Pathways for Ethnomusicology, coordinated by Suzel, who's going to talk later, and funded by FAPESP, our funding agency. As anthropologists, we have been conducting field work with people from different countries, such as Democratic Republic of Congo, Senegal, Mozambique, people that we met in São Paulo in different places and situations. This research has been conducted since the end of last year, almost 1 year from now. So it's a very recent research too. These migrants are part of a new wave of African migration to Brazil. In the last years, the numbers of African migrants and asylum seekers has risen significantly. In 2000, 1,000 regular African migrants from 38 countries lived in Brazil. In 2012, they were around 31,000 regular citizens. These numbers are not are the official numbers, but they are not exactly the right numbers, because there are lots of illegal migrants that are not counted in this. But we can see that there is an increase of in this migration from different countries in Africa to Brazil. As we are making an audiovisual ethnography, in some ways, we are involved in their musicking, both practically and institutionally. And it's important to say that we understand music, like Christopher Small, as taking part in any kind of musical engagement, performing, listening, dancing, rehearsing, and why not filming and producing films with our musicians too. In the first film I will show here, we will introduce two of our collaborators. We also want to discuss a kind of placing for African music in São Paulo and a curious observation that music can be silent. So I'm going to show a piece of this.
Eu vou cantar essa música, se chama Billy Way. Eu peço que todo mundo abra bem os olhos e ouvidos para ouvir Billy Way. Billy Way quer dizer abre os olhos. Chocolomessa. Ah, Chocolomessa. Billy Way, abre os olhos. E presta bem atenção. Fala de direitos humanos, mas são eles que matam e discriminam os imigrantes africanos da Babilônia. São eles que discriminam e recusam colher os refugiados de países vítimas de manipulação imperialista e opressão imperialista. Inventa qualquer coisa para evadir o país que tem líder e se opõe ao sistema deles imperialista, criando uma dependência política e econômica. Chegaram na África como os médicos do mundo, seja salvador do mundo.
Reduce the sound so I can earn. Sorry. In this film, we see two artists, Shambui Wetu, the performer, that's from Congo, the Democratic Republic of Congo, and Yannick Delas, that's from Congo and also from São Tomé e Príncipe. We introduced them both last April, and now they share stages and live in the same building, a very a popular house in Cambuci, where lots of migrants live in the same house. Shambui has an arts degree from the University of Kinshasa and works here in civil construction, as do many of the migrants living in Brazil. Yannick's making his living mainly by performing gigs and shows. In this film, they are playing in a refugees festival organized by FIRI, Frente Independente de Refugiados e Imigrantes, an event with concerts, performance, craftwork, clothes, and food made by migrants and refugees from Syria, Haiti, Congo, Senegal, Angola, Colombia, and Guinea-Conakry. We've participated in at least three festivals like this in the last 11 months, one in Largo da Batata, one in MIS, Museum of Image and Sound, and this one in the street under Viaduto 9 de Julho, organized by FIRI. Some of the organizers belong to both organizations. One specific way that African musics are being placed in São Paulo is through these festivals. It's worth noting that particular kinds of sociality that festivals tend to engender. Most importantly, festivals tend to change place, if not, even if only temporarily, acting to transform public spaces. Jasper Shawcraft and Paulo Magalda suggests the term festivalscapes to describe these interconnections between culture, people, and space. The crucial ingredients in São Paulo's festivalscapes are the selection of artists who are chosen to represent the diversity of refugees currently living in São Paulo, and the public, mainly middle-class, left-wing paulistanos, who are both cultural omnivores and supporters of the refugees' cause. Especially, these festivals are privileged spaces for presenting the situation of refugees and asylum seekers, and they do so in a particular way, through their cultures. According to Pichu Luambo, that's a man who speaks here in this performance, the coordinator of GRIST, Grupo de Refugiados e Imigrantes Sem Teto, de São Paulo, and also a refugee from Congo, they want to avoid yet more representations of refugees as victims. Instead, through music and culture, they want the festivals to present refugees as protagonists of their stories. In this way, refugee festivals and the movements that produce them also make use of transcultural capital to both authenticate their cause and increase its visibility. We said that musicking can be silent, and we are talking about this figure here. At the festival, Xambu Iweto made a mute performance in which he appeared with cell phones dripping blood taped to his body. This performance, named No to War in Congo, refers to metals mined in the Democratic Republic of Congo and used in the manufacture of cell phones and other electronic appliances. This mineral exploration has perpetuated one of the most violent conflicts in the world, resulting up to 20 million deaths over the last two decades, with the number of over 1,000 rapes of women every day. Without words or sounds, Shambui is musicking. In making mute performances within the musicking process of others, Shambui amplifies his politics with his body and objects, human and non-human connections, to refer to the talk in the morning. He creates chimeras, creatures from different things and beings, as a way of externalizing what comes out of his head. In this festival, his silent performance was accompanied by Yannick's song and by Pichu's discourse on the Congo War. Through musicking, these African migrants are drawing their own image of their country and continent, and also connecting it with what they already know about the country they have lived for 2 or 3 years. Their music, performance, clothes, crafts are building a distinctive space of diversity in São Paulo that, while known as the city of migrants, has yet to learn how to actually support these newcomers. Becoming African in Brazil is another topic. Musicking is also a way of negotiating identities. When we first met Yannick Delas, the musician, in a conversation organized by the artivist collective Residência Artística Cambridge, part of the Hotel Cambridge occupation, an occupation by the homeless movement of São Paulo, Movimento Sem Teto do Centro. Yannick introduced himself as a migrant musician and an international artist who came to Brazil in 2014 to promote his career. Initially, Yannick did not identify himself as a refugee or with the refugee's situation. However, over time, and through musicking in diverse spaces in the city, like these festivals, his performances have begun to soundtrack the refugee movement. On the stage of this festival, Yannick, like many other Congolese musicians, is a polyglot singer. His songs use several African languages like Lingala, Kibundu, Kikongo, as well as Creole, Portuguese, and French. His lyrics have always been political and socially oriented, but how he has performed them in Brazil helps us to understand how his identity has become increasingly multiple. Here, he is still a singer, songwriter, strongly identified with particular political issues, and eager to point out their transnational relevance. For example, in this song, Bilhue, he sings, stop corruption, stop manipulation, stop racism, stop xenophobia, stop imperialism, stop injustice, stop hypocrisy. The lyrics rail against racism and various injustices. His singing names the continent, Africa, but not specific countries. And his phrases refer to a condition that's easily recognized as Brazilian too. He says, blacks in Babylon without access to quality education, suffering discrimination in public parks, shot by the police, accused of crimes that were never committed. He could be singing São Paulo, he could be singing Brazil, and he could be singing his own country or continent. In French, he says, c'est la guerre. And we think this mix of languages featuring his music and his diasporic condition, he concludes, et toi, l'Afrique, et toi, povo preto, abre os olhos. Yannick's performance at this festival shows how a song can address realities that are distant, if not in time, certainly in space. Yannick is aware of the role that he's expected to play on a stage during a refugee day. Within a few weeks of arriving in São Paulo, he had arrived 1 month before this festival, from Minas, because he was living in Minas. He reinvented how he presented his identity from an international musician in search of success to a migrant musician who joins the cause of refugees and recognizes the struggle of Black people as a cause that unites Brazil and Africa. Such struggles also reveal some similarities regarding political expression in autocratic African states and in Brazil too. He says, this song is to talk about where I come from, Africa, but I think it's for us too, but I sing the reality of my land. Well, we know that Brazil is a country where foreigners have no right to political expression. And so this careful phrasing evidenced that Yannick is aware of this condition of being prohibited to talk about politics here in Brazil. It also demonstrates his agency in negotiating his identity with the ideological inconsistencies of Brazil's idea of itself. Bailey and Collier link migration with cultural innovation and enrichment, I quote them, which help one in dealing with a new life in a place of settlement and in the articulation of new identities. Reinventing identities is a matter for many musicians we met in this research. Lena Bahul, a dancer, singer, composer, and also musical director, born in Mozambique, has lived in Brazil since 2012. Playing with various musicians from Brazil's indie scene, if you can call it like this, she says that it was only in Brazil that she discovered herself as Moçambicana. Having studied music in the National School of Music of Maputo, Lena knew Brazilian music. She had references like Naná Vasconcelos, Hermeto Pascoal, Egberto Gismonte, and she came to Brazil to see this beautiful music, in her words. But people in São Paulo came to her concerts expecting to find something African. I'll try to put a small piece of this here. Oh, shit. Tá indo, não? Agora foi. Vou pôr mais pra frente. Vou fazer backing
vocal. E aí a gente viajou, fez uma turnê na Europa. Que foi uma bolsa parcial que eles deram e faltava. Eu não consigo ver aqui o menu. Então eu me inscrevi pra Berklee College of Music, de Boston. Foram pra lá.
Eles me mostraram, sei lá, a música de Naná Vasconcelos, a música de Hermeto Pascoale, Humberto Gismonti. Eu falei, nossa, no Brasil tem isso. Então, eu fiquei com vontade de vir para cá para ver como é que essas coisas, essas artes tão lindas eram feitas, para ver como é que eu conseguiria ver isso na minha cultura. Então, quando eu vim para cá, as pessoas, quando foram assistir meu show, elas foram com aquela expectativa de ver alguma coisa também, né, sendo africana no Brasil, né, o que, que é. E eu própria não sabia que existia essa curiosidade. Então, foi um momento de questionar a minha identidade muito forte, né? Questionar a minha africanidade, a minha negritude, a minha... Por demanda, eu tive que me olhar para ver o quanto de moçambicano ou africano realmente existe em mim.
My time is over. I will use 2 minutes then to try to conclude. Last weekend, Lena released her first CD in Brazil, Nomades, in Sesc Santo Amaro, Sesc. The event was part of the series Afro-Brasilidades of Sesc. At the same time, her musical partners and audience asked her to bring her Africanity to Brazil. And it's precisely this Africanity that's being recognized in Lena's work by a cultural institution like Sesc. The last part of what I wanted to talk here was about placing music. In fact, in this research, we note that African musicians in Brazil are being placed in at least 3 different kinds of spaces. One of the spaces is this space of festivals, this political space of recognizing a refugee or migrant identity, and they are being used in a good sense to express this migrant identity in musical festivals. The other placing is exactly this cultural institutional places in cultural institutions like SESC that creates at least 2 different distinctions for the African musicians. Lena, that has already space in this, in what we are calling an independent scene, indie scene here in São Paulo, she is placed by SESC in this Afro-Brasilidades events, but she sold as a musician, and well, her tickets were sold out 3 days before the show, like in a she has this institutional space. SESC, since we are here, has another series that's called Refúgios Culturais. Refúgios Culturais is a series for showing the culture and the diversity of cultures of migrant music and culture here, living here in São Paulo and in Brazil. Talking about with some of the organizers of this event, for example, that was Refúgios Culturais do Congo in Sesc Vila Mariana, they explained to me that they were not working with professional musicians, but with Congolese people who could show their culture, singing, making turbans, cooking, telling stories, things like this. So we see another kind of placing, the same musicians, the same migrants, that are professional musicians, where they came from, here being placed as representatives of this diversity that exists because of this new migration here in São Paulo. And well, we also have some kind of private spaces like bars, restaurants that are promoting Black nights, African nights, and are inviting these artists to sing and to play in this place. But what we would like to conclude is this political and identity building aspect of this of musicking for African musicians here in São Paulo. Lena, trying to synthesize, is not immediately political as Yannick is. Yannick has overtly social lyrics, and his performances are in spaces like refugees festivals. Rather, she's well integrated into this indie scene, music scene, and she performs in more institutional cultural spaces and music venues. And yet, she describes how it was only in São Paulo that she realized her work could also be political. Lena is working with different groups. She's working, for example, with João Taubikin, that is a bass player from this independent scene. But she's also working with a dance company that's called Gangboot, and also with Capulanas, that's a group of women in the outskirts of São Paulo. Working with these different networks that, well, we can localize in upper and middle class Vila Madalena, and also in the outskirts of São Paulo, she discovered this political, the potential of music as a political instrument, and she tells us that now she wants to come back to Mozambique for some months to work with women, to work with children, things that she never understood she could have done when she lived there before. So what we are discussing is how, in some way, music for African musicians here in São Paulo is also a way of opening our eyes to this condition, but also their eyes to the possibilities of making politica through music and trying to build new identities here in Brazil. Thank you. Você prefere? Porque... Então, espera um pouquinho. Deixa eu só tirar.